In this video, and probably for the rest of the semester, we'll spend a lot of time talking about different rates of change, namely the average rate of change, which is a concept you may have seen in your previous algebra courses, like college algebra, and instantaneous rate of change, which is the concept of derivative that we'll see very, very soon. So what's the idea of average rate of change? Well, it's very similar to slope, you may notice, how it's how the quantity, or y, changes with respect to change of quantity of x, which could be time, but it could also be different quantity, especially in business calculus. It's, again, related to slope. It's change of y over change in x. So here's the definition that may seem familiar to you from previous courses. Average rate of change. It's y value at b, f of b minus y value at a, f of a over b minus a, and you have some interval a to b, which is usually given. So average speed of or velocity is one example of average rate of change of distance over time that we'll see quite a bit. And we'll actually start with the average rate of change right away, or the computation of it. So let's take a look. What if we have a function y equals x squared plus 2x between x equals 1 and x equals 3? So again, the x values are given, but we do need to find the y values for each x, which we can simply plug in back into the equation. Notice I used function notation. And then we basically plug into the formula and we calculate it very much like we would with a slope. And here we can use a function, something like e to the x, and it was between x equals negative 2 and x equals 0, so we can plug it in. I kept this exact as e to the negative 2 power. E to the 0 we can evaluate, which is 1. So when we plug back in, again, typically I put the bigger value first on the number line as it appears. So we plug it in. 1 minus e to the negative 2 over 0 minus negative 2 becomes positive 2. And I actually plug this in the calculator as is to keep it more exact. And this is what I obtained to 4 decimal places, 0.4323. So average rate of change can show us how the quantity is increasing or decreasing over specified interval. But just like average speed, for example, if it's 60 miles an hour, doesn't mean you're going 60 miles an hour the whole time. It just means that it was average speed. Now you could be slowing down or speeding up along the way. So it doesn't quite show us how fast we're going right now, which would be the instantaneous rate of change. And it doesn't really show us the dips, for example, if they can happen, or sudden increases and so on. So it only shows us the average, which is kind of the downside of it. So the instantaneous rate of change, how do we compute it in an instant? Well, that's a little bit more difficult, but we'll explore this idea. But what you would need to do is, because you need at least 2 points to calculate the slope, you need the A and the B, the 2 points, to be fairly close to each other. So we'll explore that idea. Okay, so here's how average rate of change looks like. Notice if we have a function that's first is decreasing and then it's increasing, notice average rate of change would show us how it's increasing over time, because the slope would be positive. But it instantaneous right at that point, this actually shows that in the short term, the function, or fairly close to the point, the function would be decreasing for a little while before it starts increasing again. So notice how the slope is negative. So two very different quantities. So let's take a look. So instantaneous rate of change, again, you need 2 points very close to each other. How close, it depends on your quantity. If you're dealing in a business situation where, for example, on the cost, you can only sell integer amount of units, maybe the closest you can be is 1. So it doesn't have to be necessarily a decimal. But still, you need something like 2 points that are very close, sometimes as close as you can get. Or here is another alternative that we'll use, you may have seen before. We'll use the idea of a and a plus h as the second value. So that way the h is the difference between the two values, and I drew them fairly wide apart from one another, but we'll pretend that h is going to 0. In fact, the closer it is to 0, the more accurate our calculation is. And here is the two different ways to calculate instantaneous rate of change. That's as the limit as B goes to A or B approaches A, and we have the same average rate of change, or the limit as H goes to 0, and then we have f of A plus H minus f of A over just H, which is the difference between the two x values, and H is going to 0. Now notice, we'll probably use the second definition a little bit more because it's a little bit easier to calculate. We have seen it before in section 2.1. Rather than the first one, we could still use that, but the computation is a little bit different. So we'll use it, pardon me, let's go back. Let's take a look at instantaneous velocity. So suppose we have the position function, which is also called the distance function in physics classes, which is given to us. And we want to find instantaneous velocity at t equals 1. So we'll use the second definition. Now A would be the x value that's given, or in this case it's t that's given, so it's t equals 1. So we'll count A as 1, and notice how we can plug it in. And now notice how I often use the notation that's given to us. Instead of using f all the time, I would use the notation of the function that's given, which is s. So it's limit as h goes to 0 of s of 1 plus h minus s of 1 over h. And how I like to do this is, it depends, you can do it all at once, or you can calculate s of 1 plus h and s of 1 separately. You're plugging this in back into the original equation, so you will get 1 plus h squared plus 5 times 1 plus h plus 2, and then you can expand it. The quick way to expand it would be 1 squared, which is 1, plus twice of their product, so that's 2h, plus the last term squared, which is h squared, plus, then we can distribute the 5, plus 5, plus 5h, and then plus 2. Now note, we have quite a few like terms. For example, 1 plus 5 plus 2 would give us 8, I believe. Sorry, I had to fix the simple computation. Sometimes I can't even do simple arithmetic. I had to double check. 1 plus 5 plus 2 would actually give us 8. The idea is the same. And then we could combine 2h plus 5h, that's 7h, plus the h squared. Okay. Now s of 1, plugging back in into the original equation again, we get 8. Now notice, usually that value would match the value of the 1 plus h. Now instantaneous velocity, now I'm plugging it back in, so this would be s of 1 plus h, which is 8 plus 7h plus h squared, minus s of 1, which is 8. Now notice that both cancel, so we end up with the limit as h goes to 0 of 7h plus h squared over h. Now notice how we can factor the h and cancel it in the denominator, so that way it's no longer a problem when we plug in 0. So we are left with limit as h goes to 0 of 7 plus h, which is 7 plus 0. As soon as we plug in, notice how I drop the limit, and the answer is 7. So this is our instantaneous velocity, whether it's feet per second or miles per hour, but this is what we get. Okay, now here is another position question, which is very similar. This time we want to compute instantaneous velocity at t equals 2. So the idea is the same, a is 2. So we have the limit as h goes to 0 of s of 2 plus h minus s of 2 over h. We plug it in the same way. Now notice, if you follow the computation, because there is a constant on the front, now typically I would expand what's inside. So 2 squared, that's 4h. Then 2h, twice of that would be 4h, and then plus h squared. Then we distribute negative 2 minus 4h minus 2h minus 7. And then I distribute the 5. And so what we end up with is 20 minus 4, that's 16, minus 7, that's 9. And then 20 minus 2h, that's plus 18h, and then plus 5h squared. S of 2, similarly, we get 9. Now, instantaneous velocity is the limit as s of 2 plus h. Now, notice I plug in the whole thing, minus s of 2 over h. So we cancel the constants. So we're left with only the values that have h in it, 18h plus 5h squared. Similarly, we factor out the h and cancel. So we end up with 18 plus 5h, which ends up as 18 plus 5 times 0, which is 18. Okay, so that's how you would do it. Now, next, let's work on business application, which is profit, but it's very similar. So we're given the profit equation in hundreds of dollars from selling X items. Now we want to find average rate of change of profit from 2 to 4, and then average rate of change is similarly that we have defined before. So we do it as P of 4 minus P of 2 over 4 minus 2. So we calculate it and we get 7 as a result. And that's, recall, that's $700, or I rewrote it as $700 per item, because it's per X value. So the profit is increasing by this amount between X equals 2 and 4. Okay, so it's definitely increasing because it's positive, and we've calculated rate of change, so that's why we know it's increasing. Now we want to find instantaneous rate of change at X equals 2. This quantity is also called marginal profit. We'll use this word a lot, especially when we start doing derivatives. And again, it's A equals 2. And so we set this up similarly. Notice how I use the P now. So we calculate it very similarly as before. I plug in the 2 plus H. Again, you would expand it first and distribute it, and then collect like terms. So we end up with 4 plus 3H plus 2H squared. P of 2 is 4. And we calculate it, and the answer would be positive 3, and which becomes $300 per item. It's still increasing, but not as fast at the level of 2 items. So marginal profit is defined as increase if it's positive or decrease if it's negative of profit at a level of X items sold. So it would be different if you sell more or less. So interpretation of this question, which is also very important, the profit is increasing because it's positive by $300 per item when 2 items are sold. And that's kind of the idea here. Next, we'll do one more business application, which is demand. Now, the hardware store, the demand is N of P, which is number of boxes, at price P dollars per box is given by 80 minus 5 P squared. And P is between $1 and $4. We want to find average rate of change with a change in price from $2 to $3. And the idea is the same, N of 3 minus N of 2 over 3 minus 2. Now notice how here we get negative rate of change. That's negative 25 boxes per dollar. Now the demand, and this is what we may expect, as the prices increases from $2 to $3, the demand, or the number of boxes sold, is decreasing by 25 boxes per dollar that they sell as the price increases from $2 to $3. So that's kind of the idea with the demand. Now we want to find and interpret the average, instantaneous rate of change when the price is 2. Similar idea. Now notice we use N here with a 2. Again, so it should be a familiar computation by now. I obtain 60 minus 20H minus 5H squared. And for N of 2, obtain 60. Instantaneous rate of change. Again, the constants cancel. And then we can factor or divide by H. So we end up with negative 20 boxes per dollar. It's still decreasing. So the demand is decreasing by 20 boxes per dollar when the price is $2 per box. So that's the idea for this section.